The next item of business is members' business debate on motion 3750 in the name of John Lamont. On congratulations to Rotary District 1020 and other Champions of Change winners. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put, and I would ask those who wish to speak in the debate to press the request to speak buttons, please. And I call on John Lamont to open the debate around 7 minutes, please, Mr. Lamont.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I lodge today's motion as an opportunity to raise the excellent work of Rotary District 1020, which covers my constituency in the Borders as well as much of the south and east of Scotland. Last year, District 1020 members picked up two of the 12 Rotary Champions of Change awards, which recognise contributions to humanitarian service worldwide. I would take this opportunity to welcome them and other Rotarians from Duns, Dunbar, Larbert, Galashiels, Edinburgh and elsewhere to the gallery this evening. However, it's also an opportunity to hear about the good work done by other districts and other Rotarians across Scotland. There is much good work to speak about, and I thank the members from across the chamber who have signed the motion and are here tonight to join me in acknowledging the contribution of Rotarians to improving the lives of Scots and those elsewhere. Rotary was formed in 1905 in Chicago by Paul Harris, a Chicago attorney who, with five others, founded the Rotary Club of Chicago. These pioneers decided to hold meetings in each other's homes on a rota basis, hence the name Rotary was adopted. In 1906, the very first act of Rotary service was the provision by the Chicago Club of a public toilet outside the Chicago City Hall. From this small beginning, Rotary Club's undertaken every year practical acts of service in local communities across the world and has gone to represent 1.2 million members. Operates the world's largest educational scholarship program in the world in the form of the Rotary Foundation, and also finances the largest humanitarian program anywhere in the world. Closer to home, Rotary District 1020 covers much of the south and east of Scotland, from South Queensbury to the Scottish borders, Kilsyth to Newton Stewart, and includes Edinburgh. It has some 1,700 members, several Rotaract clubs for 18 to 30-year-olds, and a growing number of Rota Kids clubs for primary school clubs too. And like other Rotary districts, 1020 does a huge amount of fantastic and worthwhile work. Rotary clubs utilise the skills, expertise and dedication of their members to help improve the lives of people and communities both home and abroad. In the United Kingdom, that's over 50,000 men and women from all walks of life working towards positive change in neighbourhoods near and far. Whether it be fundraising for local charities, volunteering at residential homes, working with disadvantaged children, arranging the local firework or flower displays, we've all come across worthwhile projects in our own constituencies. And internationally, Rotary clubs reach out to people in need, those who are suffering from disease, malnutrition, or as first responders to natural disasters.
Excuse me, Mr. Lamont, may I stop you there? Someone has a mobile phone switched on, I suspect. Could everyone please check so? Sorry, Mr. Lamont, if you'd like to start that paragraph again.
Has it stopped?
I think so. I think they've realised. And look for the person with the red face.
So this evening, Deputy Presiding Officer, is an opportunity to celebrate and share some of the great work carried out by the clubs across Scotland. But as well as contributing to improving the lives of others, Rotary clubs also provide fellowship and companionship to its members. Volunteers are given the opportunity to develop personal skills and develop a better awareness of the problems facing the world today. And they also are given the opportunity to meet, work and have a great time with like-minded people. This aspect of Rotary life is often overlooked, but membership serves as an important purpose and provides Rotarians with an opportunity that would otherwise be difficult for some to access. In the Scottish Borders and my constituency, there are so many fantastic examples of the excellent work carried out by the District 1020. The Dictionary for Life projects, which saw all primary six pupils given a dictionary at Burnfoot School in Hawick, Rotarians keep children safe at the Border Union Show each year, and Jedburgh Rotary Club's generosity to the group of Chernobyl schoolgirls who visited the borders, kitting them out with new winter and summer shoes, thanks to the generosity of local residents. There are so many worthwhile projects that I could have mentioned. Now, in the limited time I have this evening, I would like to pick out three examples of the excellent work carried out in District 1020 last year. Grant Stephen of the Rotary Club of Duns was given a Champions of Change award last year for his outstanding work in helping the local community. Grant raised money and awareness for Alzheimer's Scotland and played a key role in the project to recognise Duns as a dementia-friendly town. Like the rest of the borders, Duns has a higher proportion of elderly people in its population than the national average, and so this work is all the more important for local residents. Robin Hamilton of the Rotary Club of Dunbar also received a Champions of Change award as a result of his involvement with the Kalimpong project in Bengal and India. The project helps tackle the problem of human trafficking by providing shelter homes and vocational training centres in India. More than 100,000 children and many more adults are estimated to be trafficked in India each year. So this is a really worthwhile initiative which Robin has helped to raise £50,000 for since the project began in 2012. And finally, the Rotary Club in Galashiels in the Borders has delivered 15 analogue breast screening lorries to India in partnership with Indian Rotary Clubs and led by local Rotarians Patricia, Paterson and Peter Croan. The increasing toll of breast cancer in developing nations is a really devastating situation. The disease, once considered as the problem of affluent nations, has now rooted firmly in developing nations like India, and this project will help towards tackling this problem. I'm delighted that some of the representatives from Rotary District 1020 are here with us this evening to celebrate their fantastic achievement last year. We have, as I mentioned earlier, we've got Robin and Carol Hamilton, Grant and Anne Stephen, and Patricia Paterson and Peter Croan, plus many others from across the district. I'm sure that we hear much more about the work from across other parts of Scotland today, but I appreciate hearing something from the Minister about what the Scottish Government is doing to support the Rotary movement. I know, for example, that many Rotary clubs are involved in delivering community payback orders in partnership with local authorities, while others are involved in the delivery of the Scottish Government-funded projects. So a partnership does exist, which I hope can be improved and developed upon. As elected representatives, we can all play a part in supporting and promoting this fantastic work in our communities. Given the hard work carried out by Rotarians, the least we can do is to give them some time to speak at their events, write about the work of our local Rotary clubs and local newspapers, or share a post or two on Facebook. I'm delighted to see the level of support in the Scottish Parliament for the Rotary movement. I know many MSPs from across Scotland are grateful for the hard work of Rotarians in their areas. They deserve our support, as without them, hundreds of thousands of pounds wouldn't be raised for charity, local projects, and local projects wouldn't be supported, and many desperate people around the world would not get the help that they need. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
May I request that those in the public gallery don't show appreciation or otherwise. Thank you very much. We now move on to the open speeches of around 4 minutes, and I call Christine Graham to be followed by Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I congratulate John Lamont on securing this debate, and while I recognise and applaud the work of all Rotarians and their voluntary and humanitarian work at home and abroad, I will, of course, restrict myself to some examples in my own constituency of Midlothian South, Tweeddale and Lauderdale, which has Rotary clubs from east to west, Melrose to Peebles and Pennycook, and of course Innerleithen, Walkerburn and Traquair and Lauderdale, as well as Galashiels and District, as mentioned in the motion. So I'll start with Gala. After meeting, as a subject mentioned by John Lamont, after meeting a surgeon from Pakistan at an awareness day, plans unfolded to send redundant medical units to Pakistan. After some discussions with the Director of National Services Division, the NHS in Scotland made available to Rotary Galashiels trailers that were previously being used for breast cancer screening due to an upgrade from analogue to digital mammography, X-ray screening technology in Scotland. Amjad, the surgeon, advised that they could still be used in Pakistan and other parts of the world where analogue equipment is still in operation. So what happened was those very trailers were shipped to Karachi, Pakistan, and thanks to a generous donation from a businessman in Pakistan, the substantial cost of shipping, $133,000, was met. Through the charity Rehabilitation Response, it was ensured that the empty space inside the units was filled with furniture to be donated to schools in Pakistan. The medical units were shipped out last year and arrived in Karachi in July, the first week in August. Patricia Paterson already mentioned, President of Rotary Galashiels and Peter Croan attended the formal handover ceremony. The delivery of these units with the facilities to undertake breast screening has raised awareness as well as providing screening. And it's no doubt that screening and the detection of breast cancer is highly important and is now in these countries recognised, not just in places such as Scotland. Other joint projects have included fridges for polio vaccination, a family project at Hand Centre, and discussions in sharing with Karachi Rotary because it's international. And several of these would be excellent for Rota Kids projects. And there's even an assessment of the possibility that clinical impact may be greater if a focus on eye screening were to be taken on board. And indeed, conversion of medical units for limb facilities or a medical facility. But moving across, we have Peebles, which is a medium-sized club with some 25 members of all ages. And they have contributed internationally and locally in the last few setting up a dental project in Nepal and a refuge for AIDS-affected children in South Africa. In Pennycook, with backpacks for Mary's Meals, and while I'm on meals, the sterling work that all of the Rotary clubs do with regard to collecting food for our own regrettable food banks, as well as collections for Macmillan nurses, whether at the end of the checkouts in the supermarket or on the streets. Pennycook also raised funds this month for trustees of the Friend of Chitambo, which is a hospital in central Zambia. In Melrose, I was pleased to welcome the Melrose Rotarians to a special lunch at Parliament with others who had adopted stations along the Borders Railway. The planting spaces at Tweed Bank are their focus locally, as well as supporting other local events. So, from flower beds to collecting tins to major charitable work, shipping medical supplies and support abroad, the Rotarians' touch in Scotland as a voluntary sector is invaluable, and I'm very pleased to support John Lamont in this motion, congratulating him on all the work they do across my constituency and elsewhere in Scotland.
I call Rachel Hamilton to be followed by Ian Gray.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm proud to be taking part in this debate today and thank my friend and colleague, John Lamont, for bringing forward this member's business tonight. I also warmly welcome the Rotary members who've joined us in the gallery this evening. Tonight, we recognise their fantastic work. They work, men and women from all walks of life, aim to contribute to the lives of others and make a positive impact home and abroad. In February 2017, just past, I attended an event here in the Parliament to celebrate the 112th worldwide anniversary of the Rotary organisation. My colleagues and I met Rotary representatives to learn more about local community initiatives and the Purple for Polio initiative, which was set up to eliminate polio throughout the world. Two Rotary members from District 1020, who are with us tonight, have made such an impact, Grant Stephen and Robin Hamilton. Recently, District Governor Andy Ireland proudly accompanied both gentlemen to the House of Lords where they received Champion of Change awards. I should declare an interest because in my career as an agronomist, I worked with Grant Stephen and I know his enthusiasm knows no bounds. It came as no surprise that Mr. Stephen's work has been recognised. His relentless campaigning to raise money for Alzheimer's Scotland was influential, with Duns being recognised as a dementia-friendly town. This is brilliant for the Borders town and brilliant for raising Alzheimer's awareness across Scotland. We all know somebody with dementia. My own grandfather had vascular dementia, which impacted hugely on our family. Every 30 minutes, someone in Scotland is diagnosed with dementia. Around 90,000 people in Scotland have dementia, and researchers now understand that one in three born in 2015 will go on to develop dementia in their lifetime, unless a cure or a vaccine is found. In the context of how prevalent this disease is becoming, I hope that towns and cities across the south of Scotland and the whole of Scotland will use Grant's work as an example of how to deliver dementia-friendly communities. Robin Hamilton from the Rotary Club of Dunbar won accolades for his work in the Kalimpong project in Bengal, in India, helping tackle human trafficking and in the process raising nearly £50,000 since the project began in 2012. Kalimpong in northeast India, close to the border with Nepal, Bhutan and China, contains many vulnerable people at risk from human trafficking because of high unemployment and a lack of steady income. Those trafficked are at risk of becoming HIV and AIDS positive, and even when rescued, risk rejection from their respective communities. To put the seriousness of the situation of human trafficking in this area into perspective, three cases in northern Bengal in 2001 increased to over 1,000 by 2010. In 2012, there were 8,000 missing girls in Bengal, often taken into trafficking on the false promise of work in the city, but instead trafficked for just $1,000. This is said to be just a small part of the picture. It is immensely saddening to hear of such practices and vulnerable people exploited to this day. However, on a positive note, Robin, through the Kalimpong Project, aims to create awareness and teach communities in trafficking and HIV and AIDS. Provide vocational training to create sustainable livelihoods and to create a shelter home for women and young girls. We can all recognise the importance of Robin's work, and it is right that we congratulate and pay tribute to this project. Deputy Presiding Officer, I know that Grant and Robin's work doesn't stop here, and they will continue to make a positive impact. I'd like to wish them all the best and congratulate them once more for receiving their Champions of Change awards, and furthermore, congratulate the Rotary International, which celebrates its 112th anniversary this year.
May we have Ian Gray and then Stuart Stevenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank you to John Lamont for securing tonight's debate and giving us the opportunity to speak about Rotary District 1020. It's a district, as he said, which stretches across south and indeed much of central Scotland. And right across that part of our country, Rotaries provide support and companionship to each other and to guests, but are also very embedded in their local communities. That's certainly the case in all five towns in my constituency in East Lothian. And that engagement is multifaceted, doing their own fundraising, providing fundraising support for other local charities, and stewarding too at important community events from the Highland Games in North Berwick to the Haddington Agricultural Show. But I want to focus this evening on Dunbar Rotary, and I should declare an interest here because I have on a number of occasions enjoyed Dunbar Rotary's hospitality, in return for which they have endured myself as a speaker for that evening. And I want to focus too on the international work of Rotary because, as speakers have already mentioned, the former president of Dunbar Rotary, Robin Hamilton, was last year awarded the Champion of Change Award 2016 for the work that he did on the project in Kalimpong. Dunbar Rotary's connection with Kalimpong started, I think, in a very Rotary fashion. It started at a meeting in Belhaven in 2011, when they had as a visiting guest Dr. Miku Foning from Kalimpong Rotary Club. And he was describing, exactly as Rachel Hamilton has just told us, the situation for many, many people in Bengal, in northeast India, their vulnerability to trafficking, to prostitution, to slavery, and to forced marriage, simply disappearing into one of these dreadful fates. Robin did not simply listen to his colleague from India's story, but responded by asking the simple question, how can we help? And from that was born the Sadhu Singh project. Robin mobilised not just Dunbar Rotary, but 16 Rotaries across Scotland and indeed as far-flung as the Czech Republic in order to raise funds, firstly to create, provide a vocational training centre where some of those at risk could learn 7 different trade skills in order to find a sustainable way to live and avoid falling into the hands of the traffickers. That included raising funds themselves, but also accessing the Rotary International Global Grant of around $69,000. And all this bore fruit last year when 7 Rotarians from Dunbar travelled to Kalimpong and took part in the opening of the vocational training centre when it was handed over to the Diocese of Churches of Northeast India, who will run the vocational training centre. But they are not resting on their laurels, and Dunbar Rotary are now working, raising funds for Phase 2, which is a shelter home for young women and girls at risk of trafficking. So it has been a marvellously successful project, but it is not, of course, yet finished. But I want to end by returning to the local, because I think this is the great strength of Rotary, isn't it? That it stretches across the world, and yet it is completely embedded with its roots in the club's own communities. Just last night, I was privileged to be a judge at an East Lothian Food Bank Girl Guide cooking competition, which was the culmination of a programme the Food Bank had undertaken with our local Girl Guide units, where they had to compete cooking using the food, kind of food which is provided by the Food Bank, all part of the Food Bank's outreach programme, and with prizes, modest prizes, but prizes nonetheless, provided by Dunbar and Musselburgh Rotary. And of course, that's not the only engagement of the Rotary with the Food Bank. They also carry out collections of food on a regular basis. So the great strength of Rotary, I think, is local and international wedded together. And I can do no better than finish with a quote from Dr. Foning when he said to Robin Hamilton in one of their meetings, he said, "We are in the river together and must swim till we get to the other side." And I believe that is what Dunbar Rotary have been doing, whether it is the river at the corner of their own street or indeed a river flowing from the foothills of the Himalayas. What a marvellous project this has been.
Well, that was a long 4 minutes, Mr. Gray, but certainly worth listening to. Can I call on Stuart Stevenson, please, to be followed by Alison Harris? I only referred to it, you understand, in case you encouraged Mr. Stevenson.
I note the requirement for 4 minutes, Presiding Officer, and use some of them to congratulate John Lamont on bringing this topic to Parliament. I'm grateful for the opportunity to speak on the subject of Rotary. I welcome the times when we as a Parliament look to the actions of hard-working Scottish citizens and citizens across the world, and in particular tonight, reflecting on the work of people in our nation's Rotary clubs, the motto of Rotary International, service above self. And if we've heard anything from contributions so far, it has exemplified that motto. The awards we recognise tonight are a small enough gesture when compared to all the hours of compassionate service that club members have given. I can't help wondering what the world would look like if we didn't have Rotary, if more people followed their example. We might have to invent Rotary if that had not happened 112 years ago. Now, for my part, Rotary has been part of my life for a very, very long time. Not, I may say, in District 1020. I was brought up in Cooper and Fife. My father was the president of the Rotary Club there in 1956 to 57. I myself first spoke to the Rotary Club there, I think, in 1962, when on the Sons and Daughters evening, which the club had organised, I was responsible for the vote of thanks to the members. I certainly spoke to them in 1974 on my career, which was computers, and a sorry tale of computer failures and difficulties. When I revisit that speech, it is on my website if you wish to go and look at it under the comments section. You can see what I said to Rotary in 1974. It will take you the distant history. But the Rotary Club then, as now, seeks to try and educate, supports the efforts of others, it inspires and empowers people across the globe. And I think tonight we are focusing in particular on the Rotary's four-way test that's part of their guiding principles as a club. It's an ethical guide to behaviour and one I think we can all learn from. It reads, of the things we think, say or do, is it the truth? Is it fair to all concerned? Will it build goodwill and better friendships? Will it be beneficial to all concerned? And I can certainly speak for my part that friendship was a key part of what my father got out of being Rotary and what he was able to contribute to Rotary. The people who I see in these old photographs of the Rotary Club are all people I recognise and were an important part of my life. But I also knew what they did to support the local community and communities across the world. If the test, the ethical guide that Rotarians seek to live their lives by and to operate as Rotarians were adopted by us all in our own lives, we would be doing something quite special. We would run out of awards to give to people if everyone were to be serving. But that'd be no bad thing. We should aim for a day when we're a little less selfish, a little more selfless. I celebrate the efforts of Rotary clubs in Scotland. I hope that they will continue to evolve. I know that in my period in contact with them, they're very different from they were 60 years ago. For example, they now have women members and all the better for it. They reach much further across the world. In the 1960s, Cooper Rotary Club reached to Japan, and this was thought extraordinarily novel. Let me wish them every success whatsoever in the future. Their early promise when, after only 16 years, they were already established in six continents. Maybe we should invent some more. They'd be there before we turned our back on them. Presiding Officer.
Last of the open speeches is Alison Harris.
Presiding Officer. I'm delighted that my colleague, John Lamont, has brought this subject forward for members' business this afternoon. Rotary and organisations such as Probus, Rotaract, Inner Wheel, Rota Kids, Roundtable and Ladies' Circle are known for their fellowship and for raising funds for those less fortunate than ourselves. At this stage, I would like to just declare an interest and say that I am a past chairman of Falkirk Ladies' Circle and I certainly enjoyed many, many fun years being part of that group. Champions of Change is annual recognition by Rotary International in Great Britain and Ireland to particular people, those unsung heroes who go that extra mile in assisting others or inspiring others to do so. People such as Robin Hamilton from Dunbar, a member of his local Rotary Club, and I know we've heard about the following people already, but they really are worth mentioning again. Several years ago, Robin met a fellow Rotarian from a small part of India, sandwiched between Nepal, Bhutan and China, a prime target area for those who deal in people trafficking. With many vulnerable people, high unemployment and an escalating number of people being reported as missing, something really had to be done. A project was set up locally to highlight the issue and reduce the stigma of trafficked women returning, often with AIDS and HIV. Plans were made for a shelter home to be set up for women and young girls and work commenced on a vocational training centre. While some funds and grants became available, it was clear that the costs were far beyond what could be raised locally. Enter Robin and the Rotary Club of Dunbar. With assistance from a number of clubs from Scotland, England, India and the Czech Republic, working with local bodies, funds were raised for phase one to complete the training centre, such as security fencing, sanitation, electrical work and furniture. Training courses will then be run covering subjects such as tailoring, animal welfare, carpentry and horticulture. Phase two will involve the shelter home for trafficked women and girls. What a difference these will make to the life of these people. Not all champions of change are making a difference to people overseas. Some like Grant Stevens of Duns, as my colleague Rachel Hamilton has already mentioned, worked tirelessly in his local community, raising awareness of a dementia and assisted in the setting up of a dementia-friendly cafe in Duns. A member of the Rotary Club of Galashiels, Patricia Paterson, was also approached by a doctor who did corrective work on children in Pakistan. He mentioned that soon-to-be-redundant NHS breast screening units would be of great benefit to his work in Pakistan. They could be used not only for breast screening, but as mobile operating theatres and polio immunisation centres. Aided by fellow Rotarian Peter Croan, thoughts turned to the logistics of getting the units to Pakistan and meeting the $133,000 cost of shipping. Due to a generous donation from a Pakistani businessman, work getting the units from Hamilton to Karachi gathered pace. The units were filled with furniture, which could be distributed to schools in Pakistan. Support was given by the British High Commission, and the project received positive coverage in Pakistan, both for Rotary and for Scotland. On August the 13th, 2016, 10 former NHS breast screening units were officially handed over. The ceremony was attended by the Chief Minister of Sindh Province, who warmly thanked both NHS Scotland and the Rotary Club members from Galashiels. Further, Presiding Officer, I'm advised by past District Governor Andy Ireland that the Galashiels Club intend to deepen the links that they have established through this project and will continue to support projects to improve the lives of people in Pakistan. I have touched on a few stories of ordinary people who are doing extraordinary things. I hope tonight they feel that they are no longer unsung heroes. They are indeed champions for change, and people whom this Parliament recognises have truly put service before self. Thank you.
I call Alistair Allen to respond to this debate. Around 7 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and can I thank John Lamont for his efforts in bringing this debate to Parliament. It gives me great pleasure to acknowledge the tremendous work of our Rotary clubs and welcome many of their members to the gallery tonight. They're part of an outstanding worldwide organisation, as we've heard, which works at local, national and international level to run successful campaigns that save lives across the globe. Rotarians have been using their skills and links to clubs across the world to work to alleviate some of the causes of poverty in countries in which millions of people die of starvation and from diseases that could be prevented by clean water, proper sanitation or medicines. Members have built links with national and international charities, NGOs and community groups to promote projects to eradicate hunger and malnutrition, reduce child mortality and help disease prevention and indeed education for all. When natural disasters strike anywhere in the world, Rotarians are very often some of the first people to take action, organising collections, raising large sums of money for the various charities that are best equipped to provide relief for those in need. And as Mr. Gray pointed out, we should of course also remember that Rotary not only makes its mark overseas, but also here in our own communities. Today we've heard some great local examples of the contribution that Rotary has made to the lives of people across Scotland. Everything achieved by Rotary International and the Rotary Foundation depends entirely on the work of local clubs like the Rotary Club of Duns or Dunbar or Galashiels. The cause of charitable endeavour of, or as the Rotary motto puts it, service above self, makes a noticeable impact on people and communities across Scotland and beyond. Indeed, this government is clear that volunteering matters. It has huge economic significance, contributing over £2 billion to Scotland's economy every year. But perhaps more important than that is the fact that without volunteers, many of our communities would simply cease to function. People all across Scotland make absolutely vital contributions every day to their families, communities, and to society as a whole, doing what they believe in, usually without fanfare or any reward, but because they believe in the same things we all believe in: equality for all, a fair society, a chance for everyone to participate and to make a difference. Volunteering is good for the volunteer too, building skills, enhancing employability, supporting mental well-being. And at its best, volunteering in Scotland is already making a crucial contribution to building social capital, fostering trust, binding people together, and making our communities better places to live and work. And to pick up on Mr. Lamont's question about what sources of potential assistance might be available to Rotarian projects, I would say that the most relevant such sources of funding to any voluntary organisation would include the Community Capacity and Resilience Fund, the Empowering Communities Fund, and the Volunteer Support Fund. We recognise the numerous contributions that volunteers make as carers, providers, mentors, leaders, and in many other roles. We want to continue to support people to volunteer and to contribute on the issues that matter to them. And this is crucial to our wider aim of creating a fairer, smart, inclusive Scotland with genuine equality of opportunity for everyone. It's also true that in an increasingly globalised yet uncertain world, Scotland must remain internationally relevant. Scotland's international framework, published in March 2015, sets the direction for Scotland's international activity, and the twin aims of our international framework are, firstly, to create an environment within Scotland that supports a better understanding of international opportunities and a greater appetite and ability to seize them. And secondly, to influence the world around us on issues that matter most and helping Scotland to flourish. The framework also acknowledges Scotland's desire to be a good global citizen, making distinctive contributions in addressing global challenges such as climate change, tackling inequality, and promoting human rights. Last year, we updated Scotland's strategies for engagement with specifically India and Pakistan, which may be of interest. And these strategies look at how we can build sustainable partnerships in education, business, energy, water, and culture. We're committed to building partnerships that have mutual benefit, allowing those countries to achieve their goals whilst collectively reducing inequality and building opportunities for mutual learning. So I'd like to take this opportunity to commend the Rotaries in Dunbar and Galashiels for their work in India and Pakistan to provide sanitation in schools and to provide access to breast screening. As we've heard, such work is a clear demonstration of the fact that the international links are not simply for government and its agencies to pursue, important though that is. They're there also for individuals and organisations to make the connections that impact so much on people's lives. It is impressive, Presiding Officer, that community groups across the country are working tirelessly to improve lives, not just in Scotland, but as we've heard, around the world. It is evidence that our relationship with our friends and our communities in other parts of the world is truly a combined effort being built up not just by governments, but by individuals and communities across Scotland, with much of this being driven by groups such as our Rotary clubs. So to conclude, it has been a very positive debate. I do possibly feel personally cheated that I did not attend the 1974 Cooper Rotarian meeting at which Mr. Stevenson explained his views on computer programming, but no doubt after today much traffic will have been driven to his website to correct that historic wrong. But I would like in closing to echo that it has given me great pleasure to acknowledge the tremendous work of our local Rotary clubs and also offer congratulations to Rotary International, which is celebrating its 112th anniversary this year. With the success of Scottish Rotary Clubs at the 2016 Champions of Change Awards, may I wish our Rotary Clubs all the best for the 2017 Awards taking place in April. This will once again recognise unsung heroes in domestic and international categories, and we should, Presiding Officer, all work to ensure that Rotarians who are making a difference and volunteering their time for the benefit of others do, as today, get the recognition that they deserve.
This meeting is closed, and our visitors may show their appreciation, or otherwise, as they wish.